Hi, welcome to Granite State Outdoors. In today's episode, we'll be digging into Fish and Game's film archives to see how New Hampshire managed one of its important fisheries back in the 50s. We'll then explore New Hampshire's vast snowmobile trail system and get a primer on ice fishing. These stories and more, all up next on GSO.
Landlocked salmon, lake trout, rainbows, these and other species of game fish provide excellent fishing in New Hampshire's many large, deep, clear lakes. These big fish require tremendous amounts of forage fish for food. In New Hampshire, salmon and lake trout depend on smelt as their principal food item. Each spring, during the period of ice out in the lakes, tremendous numbers of adult smelt leave the lake and descend streams in which to spawn. If no streams are present, spawning will take place along the shorelines, with practically any type of bottom being utilized for spawning areas. In Winnesquam Lake, one of the inlets most heavily used by smelt for spawning activities is Black Brook, Sanbringen, New Hampshire. Let us follow the smelt as they come in from the lake and start up Black Brook to spawn. After passing through the sluggish area where the river enters the lake, the smelt swim upstream until they reach swift water flowing over sandy or gravel bottom areas. It is here that most of the natural spawning will take place. In the inlets to most lakes, the spawning runs occur from just after dusk until the early hours of the morning. But at Black Brook, the smelt are not disturbed, and many remain in the spawning area throughout the entire day. The males, or jacks as they are called, generally precede the females by about a week to 10 days, usually dropping back into the lake proper during the daylight hours. In Lake Winnesquam, the spawning run starts about the first week of April, but females do not begin to appear until about the second week, and the actual spawning starts somewhere around the 20th of the month. The spawning activity will reach its peak about the first week of May and is generally over by the 15th of the month. During the spring, hundreds of people eagerly seek these small silvery fish with long-handled dip nets. But because of the importance of our smelt egg program for providing sources of food for salmon and lake trout throughout the state, this particular brook is closed to smelt dipping. Here at Black Brook, an artificial spawning site, 80 feet long by 20 feet wide, has been constructed by the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department. This area with a concrete bottom has been divided into five raceways. From the time the females start depositing their eggs until the end of the spawning activity, one or more section will remain open so the smelt can enter. Since it is natural for a smelt to swim upstream, they will fill the raceway from the head all the way down to the lower end. Wooden frames covered with burlap make an efficient, low-cost tray on which to collect the eggs. The trays are anchored to the bottom and held fast by large rocks. The rocks also act as barriers, forming eddies and pools behind them, which provide resting places for the smelt after their tiresome journey upstream to the spawning sites. The flow of water through each raceway is regulated by flashboards in the dam at the head of the raceway. After a set of burlap trays has been placed in a raceway and made ready for the collection of smelt eggs, the flow of water through the raceway is increased, urged on by the extra flow. Tremendous numbers of smelt will ascend and completely fill the raceway, resulting in maximum numbers of eggs deposited and collected each night. Here we can see the smelt over the trays, facing upstream, ready to spawn. Since this brook fluctuates greatly during the spring, it is necessary to control the amount of water rushing through the artificial spawning area. This is possible through the use of flashboards in the dam situated at the lower end of a bypass, especially constructed for this purpose. During heavy rainfalls, when the brook tends to flood over, boards are removed so that the excess water will rush down through the bypass. If the brook becomes low, the spillways are closed, backing up the brook so that the water must then pass over the dam at the head of the collecting area, thus guaranteeing that fresh amounts of water will constantly be flowing over the trays of smelt eggs. Since the spawning season for suckers is approximately the same as that of the smelt, it became apparent that unless a method was devised to prevent suckers from spawning on the trays, fertilized sucker eggs would be transplanted along with the smelt eggs. Wooden-framed wire screens keep suckers from entering the raceways. These screens must be kept clean of leaves and other debris to prevent the water from building up behind them and eventually spilling over the top. If this happens, then suckers are able to leap this waterfall and pass into the smelt egg collecting area. To prevent this from happening, the screens must constantly be turned and cleaned. It is also necessary to keep these screens clean in order that the smelt can pass through them. The smelt can quickly and easily pass through these coarse screens and into the spawning area. Here they will deposit millions of eggs on the trays each night. Both male and female smelt appear alike in regard to size, color, and external appearance. However, the males are covered with breeding tubercles during the spawning season and feel gritty, whereas the female smelt lack these tubercles and feel very smooth when picked out of the water. Preliminary work has indicated that many smelt in Winnesquam Lake spawn when they are 1 year old and average about 4.5 inches in length. A few large females, 8 to 10 inches, spawn in Black Brook each year. These fish have been found to be 3 years old. Taking scales from these smelt and recording their length and sex on the scale envelopes is done in the field laboratory at Black Brook. Later, the scales will be read to learn the ages of the spawning smelt. Before the concrete spawning area was constructed, the egg trays were just placed on the brook bottom and anchored with large rocks on each corner. Unfortunately, after the trays were left to collect eggs for 2 or 3 nights, tremendous amounts of sand and gravel accumulated on the trays along with the eggs. Very often, many or all of the trays collected only a few eggs. In many cases, many of the eggs collected were lost due to suffocation because of sand and gravel which completely buried them. By comparison, the trays in the collecting area are not subject to this condition of heavy silting which would result in egg suffocation. Both trays were set at the same time. The tray set on the brook bottom is practically covered with sand and gravel, whereas the tray taken from the raceway has about a 1/4 inch layer of smelt eggs and is free of all other matter. Notice the even distribution of the smelt eggs on the tray taken from the collecting area in contrast to the tray set on the brook bottom. As the smelt proceed up into the collecting area, the entire raceway becomes so crowded that it is sometimes almost impossible to see the bottom. From these vast numbers of smelt that come up and spawn, a few will die. Some become crushed against the rocks or manage to wiggle under a tray or rock, which might kill them. These dead fish may then become infected with a fungus parasite, which, if left untreated, could spread over and completely infect and kill an entire raceway of eggs in 2 or 3 days. To prevent this, each raceway of eggs is given a daily treatment of malachite green. The crystals are measured by weighing and are then dissolved into a gallon of water. This standard solution is poured into a drip pail at the head of the raceway, where it slowly pours from the pail into the water flowing over the egg trays. The solution flows over and completely covers each tray of eggs. All raceways are given a 1-hour treatment each day. This treatment has resulted in the complete elimination of egg losses from the fungus parasite. As the season progresses, the waters recede and any eggs in the brook which become exposed to air and sunlight dry out, die, and turn white. Fortunately, this condition can be prevented by controlling the water flow over the eggs in the collecting area. Each tray will contain up to 500,000 live, fertile smelt eggs. In managing lakes for this important forage fish, it is important that we know how many eggs are stocked in each lake each year. To obtain this information, lead plates covered with burlap 4 inches square or 16 square inches in area are set at random on the trays along the entire length of the raceway. After the eggs have collected on the trays for a few nights, these plates are picked up. Since only a very few smelt eggs will stick to the wooden frames, a person is able, by stepping only on the wooden portion of the trays, to walk along the raceways without destroying many smelt eggs. Smelt eggs are very sticky when deposited and adhere to the burlap covering on the plates, just as they do on the burlap smelt trays. White thumbtacks are stuck into the lead plates, so they will be easy to find after the trays and plates have been covered with smelt eggs. The eggs are then removed from the plates into a pan of water. These eggs have already become water hardened, and it is now a very simple matter to roll the eggs off the plate by hand. After being measured, these eggs are placed in a brook below the collecting area where they will later hatch. After all the eggs are removed from the plates, they are poured into a glass graduate, which is measured in cubic centimeters. Samples taken resulted in an average egg count of 835 eggs per cubic centimeter. By measuring the number of cubic centimeters of eggs collected on the plates, it is possible to determine the number of eggs collected per square inch on each tray. The number of eggs collected per tray is carefully recorded, making it possible to know how many eggs are stocked in each lake. The biologist performs numerous investigations and devises methods and techniques designed to improve the quality of the eggs being shipped out. Meanwhile, the smelt continues to battle their way up and into the raceways and spawn. Nature's driving forces will make them fight with their lives to pass all obstacles until they reach a suitable area to spawn. As soon as an adequate number of eggs have been deposited on the trays, about 500,000 eggs per tray, the coarse screen at the lower end of the raceway is removed, the smelt are driven out, and a fine meshed 1/4 inch wire screen is put in its place. This screen will prevent the smelt from re-entering the raceways and depositing more eggs on the trays. The trays of eggs in this raceway will be held at Black Brook until the eggs are eyed. This will take approximately 12 to 15 days. Samples of eggs that are being held are picked up each day with a syringe. The eggs are then transferred into labeled bottles so that eggs from each lot of trays can be identified. The eggs are then put into glass dishes and checked through a microscope. Hundreds of eggs can be checked in a very few minutes. By checking different lots of eggs, we are able to determine in how many days they will hatch. Thus, we can plan on stocking the trays 1 or 2 days prior to the eggs hatching. This will result in maximum hatching success in each lake that is stocked. Valuable data obtained with the help of the microscope is recorded on the smelt egg charts. Records of each set of trays placed in a raceway are kept. Information obtained includes the degree of embryo development, percentage of fertile eggs, and the general condition of entire lots of eggs. As soon as microscopic investigation reveals that a lot of smelt eggs are about ready to hatch, the trays are given a final treatment of malachite green. Any silt which may have accumulated on the trays is washed off as the trays are removed from the raceway. Every other tray has wooden cleats fastened to the top at the center. When the trays are stocked, they are stacked too high. The cleats keep the trays apart so that clean water can pass between them and prevent destruction by suckers and other predators. The water flowing between the trays will wash the newly hatched smelt fry into the brook and down into the lake. The trays, each containing approximately 500,000 eyed smelt eggs, are then loaded on a pickup truck. After the egg trays are loaded on the truck, the entire lot is covered with wet burlap bags. A few pails of water are poured over them as a final precaution against drying. A tarpaulin is spread over the entire load and tied down. Although most trips average less than 6 hours, some eggs are shipped by truck 8 to 10 hours without any losses. The truck driver checks the load every couple of hours and wets the egg with brook water if necessary. Earlier work involving shipping techniques proved that eggs could be successfully shipped in this manner for periods up to 36 hours if the eggs were kept moistened. Finally loaded, the truck has about 80 to 100 trays, or roughly between 40 and 50 million eyed smelt eggs as it starts its trip to various stocking sites. As the truck leaves, a conservation officer radios the officer who is to receive the eggs that the truck is on its way and tells him where and when to meet it. Meanwhile, the raceway just emptied is swept clean. A new set of trays is put in place. New count plates are randomly spaced, and the fine mesh screen is removed from the lower end. This raceway will soon be ready to collect 94 more trays of smelt eggs, numbering approximately 40 million. As soon as the screen is removed and the water flow through the raceway is increased, these smelt will again enter the raceway to continue spawning. Arriving at the lake to be stocked, the fish and game manager meets the conservation officer scheduled to receive the eggs. Now both the manager and conservation officer will carry the egg trays along the brooks as close to the lake as possible. The trays are set in clean running water on a sandy or gravel bottom and are held in place by large rocks. These trays were held at Black Brook for a period of about 15 days. During this period, the embryos have fully developed and are about ready to hatch. Within 2 or 3 days, tremendous numbers of fry will hatch from each egg tray. Practically all the eggs on each tray will have hatched within 5 days from the time the egg trays were transferred from Black Brook to the stocking site in a lake. Finally, the payoff. After weeks of careful planning and scientific management at the smelt egg collection station at Black Brook, here we can plainly see the smelt embryos fully developed and twitching in their eggshells just prior to hatching. Finally, an extra kick and the fry break from their shell case and are able to swim and start life. From each tray, about 500,000 of these tiny transparent smelt fry will hatch and be carried to the lakes. In the lakes, millions of these smelts serve as the most important forage food to produce or grow large game fish such as this. Smelt in New Hampshire's large lakes have proved to be the necessary link in the food chain needed for producing large, fighting, landlocked salmon, such as seen here. Even though millions of smelt will be devoured by game fish each year, many will manage to survive, grow to maturity, and spawn. Each year, about 400 million eggs will be collected, treated, cared for, and transplanted from Black Brook. About 88% of the total egg stock will hatch. This high rate of hatching success has been made possible through research and sound fisheries management practices conducted at the Black Brook Smelt Egg Collection Station.
We hope you're enjoying Granite State Outdoors. If you have comments, you can email us at gso@wildlife.nh.gov. In the meantime, check out this next story.
New Hampshire boasts more miles of snowmobile trails than it has in paved interstate highways. The views and vistas rivals many scenic drives.
Hi, I'm Mark Beauchamp with New Hampshire Fishing Game. With me is Craig Mayo with the New Hampshire Snowmobile Association. Craig, we're on a beautiful day out in New Hampshire.
It's gorgeous.
We came out of Rumney,
Baker River, Rumney area.
Where are we heading?
Well, we're heading towards Lyme. We're kind of at a trail junction between Baker River's trail system and Lyme's trail system.
We're on Corridor 5.
Correct.
Where does that go? It
starts down at the bottom of the western part of the state and runs all the way up through the Canadian border in Pittsburgh. All the trails up here are high elevation, so it's good early riding and good late riding because of the elevation.
Craig, you know, like I said, it's been years since I've ridden on trails. They're outstanding today. I mean, the grooming is just fabulous. Who takes care of these trails?
Well, this is a combination of two clubs. You've got on this side here, Lyme Pinnacle, and on this side, Baker River. And they have a couple pieces of equipment, tuckers, piston bullies, and they come out here and they volunteer hours. They come out and groom the trails. And obviously, you can see by the pass here that they've just come and done this one.
What's the property situation here?
Most of the trails in New Hampshire are all on private property, so they have landowner permission to be out here, and it's the club has to seek that every year for the next season. And so it's private property.
So it's important that we respect that landowner's rights, or our rights to be able to ride on their land, that they're given to us by that landowner.
Oh, most definitely. I mean, the landowner relationship's key.
What are some of the things that an average rider like me could do to foster that landowner relationship?
Well, whatever you bring in, take out.
Excellent.
Ride responsibly and stay to your side of the trail. If you see, you never know who you're gonna see out there, and you know, be careful what you say to who you say it to, because it could be the landowner.
Snowmobiling helps extend your friends and family network, or can offer solitude and escape. Along the way, you may encounter some locals. Snowmobiling New Hampshire, a great way to take the road less traveled.
Hi, I'm Zach Esklund, and this is my introduction to ice fishing. So I'm here with Mark Beauchesne. Why are we stopping here?
Well, Zach, we need to get some bait. We're here at Wayne Hall's to get some shiners. Come on in, let's get them.
Hey, Wayne, can we get a dozen mediums and you know, some nice lively ones? Right.
We were here the other day.
You were ice fishing here the other day?
And, hold froze up a couple inches, but give us a place to start.
Yeah.
Tip up, basically it's kind of an automated fishing device, measuring device called sounder. Just clips on, drop the sounder down. I'm just kind of putting my finger on the spool so it doesn't overspool.
Oh, okay.
And when it hits the bottom, it stops. 12, 13 feet, so I'm gonna wind the line onto the spool. See how it's kind of slack?
Yeah.
If you pick up on it, you can feel where it tensing.
Our fish are generally higher. The water.
Here they could be coming in. That's why we're using the tip up, so we can experiment. High level, mid level, low level. The best way to do this, they make little scoops. But I just assume pick them up, turn them upside down, and people hook them different ways. I like to hook them through the lips. We feed the line in. The sinker's gonna pull the fish down. Yeah, about 4 feet. That's one, five more to go. So why don't you do the next set.
This looks pretty gear intensive, Mark.
Well, actually it is, but it isn't. I mean, every tool has a purpose. Yep, I think you hit the bottom. See how it backspun?
Yeah. Okay.
So you're gonna wanna straighten that out because now the line's on the wrong way. Set this one just up off the bottom. Grab it. This guy on there.
Okay.
All right, pull her up, take the sounder off, bait her up, and set her, and we're good to go to the next one.
Oh. So what's this, Mark?
Power auger.
Power auger.
We went from using the hand chisel to open holes that were already open. There's not a hole here, so I'm gonna use the power auger. It's a small four-stroke motor. Uh-huh. With an auger and blades below that basically shaves the ice to make a hole. A lot of people like to just put them ups out, and that's good enough. And
just,
you know, throw a football around, chill out on the ice, whatever it may be. I like to take it to the next level, put up, do some jigging.
Do some jigging, all right. Let's do some jigging.
We'll each gonna grab a jigging rod and a hole and some bait. And jigging rod's not much different than a regular fishing rod we use in the summertime. We have a small jig on there and our live bait. It can either be a piece of regular old worm.
No, so we're not going to use the fish for these.
This one we're going to use these little larvae called Euro larvae. Different colors. There's a fat end and a skinny end, and we just hook the fat end right on the hook. And you can see they kind of wiggle and do their thing.
Uh-huh.
And I hold the rod real, real light. And I watch the tip of the rod tip also. So when I'm moving it, I'm not moving it a lot. Basically, what I want to do is want to imagine that I'm staying within this circle, jigging up and down. And you want to keep a nice straight line. So what we're first going to do is send this thing right to the bottom. So you just want to bomb that to the bottom. That's about it, and just kind of make two cranks.
Yep.
Now you can just kind of shake, shake, shake. And every now and then, stop. And just hold still. Yeah, just hold still.
Trying to keep in that little box.
Yeah, just a little box, a little shake, 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 and then stop.
Do you find you're more successful with jigging or with the tip-ups?
I'm more successful with jigging because that's my favorite thing to do.
Is there any consistency to where they are?
There tends to be with some species of fish. Some fish will be found in the upper water column and some will be found on the lower water column. All right.
I think it's that same guy.
Little black crappie. Crappie.
A crappie.
Very good eating fish, about twice that size. Kiss him? Yeah.
What else we got to use today? I saw you bringing out something that looked like a fish finder.
We brought the fish finder. We'll see how we can do with that.
All right.
But do we really need it if we're catching fish without it?
I think you're catching the fish. I think I might need a fish finder. We just took this day up about three levels.
Yep. Well, we're stepping up into the modern technology now. This is basically sonar unit, much like what they use on the submarines and things like that. Yep. This is in feet, and it comes down in a cone angle, so 12 degrees, and then it spreads out wider and wider as deeper the water goes. We're maybe covering a swath, maybe 10-foot circle right here at
fish are within 10 feet of this?
Within 10 feet of the transducer cone. So you see that one going back down now?
Yeah.
Okay, at 10 feet, it's going to meet up with the rest. And I can't stand this. You better put that jig in there. See multiples, I try to just do as little as I can and let the competition deal with it. Slack in the line. You just knock slack in the line. Lift up. Say this is easy. It's not.
It's not really easy.
It's not easy. I mean, you say, oh, you got that fish finder to help you. Well, you still have to hook the fish.
You still have to get them.
Yeah. Boink. Boink.
Hey.
Hey. All right.
All right. Thanks for taking me fishing today, Mark. I'm Zach Esklund, and I'll see you out on the ice.
For more information on hunting, fishing, or wildlife watching, or to download maps of state lands and lakes, just log on to the Fish and Game website at wildnh.com.
Today I'm going to talk to you about some of the essential things you need if you go on a day hike. The first essential thing you should always carry on a day hike is a map and a compass. A map is going to tell you where to go. It shows you the trails that you're on, it can give you distance, and a compass will help you orient yourself if you get lost. This is a first aid kit, it's a basic first aid kit, and this is essential in case you get hurt while you're out day hiking. Something very important to have on the trail is extra food. You never know when you're going to need a snack, or you might be out for longer than you think. Another thing you'll really need for a day hike is at least 2 liters of water. You're also going to want to carry 2 trash bags on your hike. Trash bags can serve as emergency shelter, and they're wonderful pack liners. You'll also want to have matches or a lighter in a waterproof bag. You'll also want to bring a multi-tool or penknife on your day hike. This can be useful if you need to cut ropes or other things in an emergency situation, or for making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You'll also want to carry sunscreen on your day hike. If you get burned, it's going to make your experience a lot less pleasant. You can also bring lip balm or something similar to protect your lips. 2 other things you're going to want in your day pack are a whistle and a light source. A whistle will help you to be heard if you get in trouble, and you can blow it for longer and it will be louder than your voice. A light source will help you see in case you get caught out in the woods after dark. You'll also want to bring a rain layer and extra warm layers for when you're out in the woods. You never know when the weather might change, and you want to be prepared.
Hi, I'm Carrie Rhodes from the Appalachian Mountain Club, and today I'm going to give you some other tips for preparing for changing trail conditions. Before you hit the trail, you should check the weather conditions, make sure you have all the essentials in your pack, and leave a plan for someone at home. The plan should include the route you're going to follow, an estimated time that you'll be back, and also a time for them to alert authorities if you do not return. In cold weather or when going up in elevation, you want to be prepared for encountering ice on the trail. It's important to bring along some sort of traction device. When you're putting on your traction device, be sure to sit on a pad so you can insulate yourself from the cold ground. You can also use your pack if you don't have a pad. It's important to dress in layers made of non-cotton materials. Start with a base layer like Polypro. Then you want an insulating layer like fleece, wool, or down. Finally, finish with a layer that's going to protect you from both rain and wind. It's important to take plenty of breaks in the winter because you want to keep well fed and well hydrated, which will both keep you warmer. When you slow down or take a break, make sure you put on another layer so you stay warm. Also, when you're hiking, make sure you pace yourself. You want to avoid sweating because when you sweat, you're going to get colder. Be sure to keep an eye on your watch and turn around to make it back to the trailhead with enough time before it gets dark. Remember, in late fall and winter, the days are much shorter. Good hike. Hey, Carolyn, we need to remember to call your mom when we get back to the car so she knows that we're safe.
Well, you never know what you're going to see in New Hampshire's great outdoors, like this porcupine. Thanks for watching Granite State Outdoors. I'm John Charpentier for New Hampshire Fish and Game. I'll see you next time on GSO.